My name's Adam Menaka, and I'm the financial controller for High Tech Oils. With our national capacity, we can now service Australian companies nationwide. Of late, we have now expanded into the New Zealand market. Here at High Tech Oils, we receive premium base oils and premium additive packs. Together with our highly trained staff, we manufacture over 500 premium quality products. High Tech Oils is Australian made and Australian owned.
On today's show, we look back on the season that was in the FIA World Endurance Championship with the 2016 season review. Then we return to Sydney Motorsport Park for our continued final round coverage of the Swan Insurance Australasian Superbike Championship, featuring the Supersports and the AmSport 600s. This is Speedweek.
...2016 was the biggest season yet in the FIA World Endurance Championship. Nine tough races around some of the best tracks across the globe. This is the story of an epic season.
Silverstone means racing. People from this country, they understand what racing's all about. Historic, fast, British motorsport.
The fans were out in force at Silverstone in the UK, which has become the traditional opening chapter in the story of every WEC season. For the teams, it would finally be a chance to see if all the long hours of development and testing over the winter had paid off. In LMP1, Porsche were the reigning champions. They knew that they now had a target on their backs. They returned with an even more powerful 919 hybrid. Audi were gambling on a switch to a 6 megajoule battery in their hybrid system to try and get them back on top. As for Toyota, after a disappointing 2015, they'd almost started from scratch for the new TSR50. In LMP2, things were looking very competitive, with a strong field of drivers, as well as new teams entering the battle. There was a real air of anticipation in the GTE Pro class. Aston Martin, Ferrari and Porsche had new challenges, and the arrival of Ford was guaranteed to shake up the established teams.
Our goal has to be to try and win in the first year. But we know that endurance racing and 24-hour races and Le Mans is, you know, a unique challenge.
And in GTE Am, the competition was looking just as intense. ...2016 was looking strong, so it was time to get the season underway. Qualifying Audi showed they meant business this year and made a great start pulling away from the charging pack. However, the Porsches soon found their feet and came back. Mark Webber was flying and caught André Lotterer, blasting past him to take the lead with a stunning manoeuvre. The 2015 world champions showing they were up for the fight. After a blistering start, Webber pitted from the lead and handed over to teammate Brendan Hartley. In GTE Pro, the new AF Corsa Ferrari 488 was dominating the class early on. Davide Rigon swapped with Sam Bird. Meanwhile, despite a promising start, the new Ford GTs run by Chip Ganassi Racing was starting to slip back, unable to keep up the pace. But it was only the first race for the new team. The front of the field, Ben Trelawney had taken over the number 7 Audi and was hunting down the leader, scything his way through the traffic. Porsche knew he was coming and were feeling the pressure. Brendan Hartley pushed a bit too hard and hit Mike Wainwright, crashing out of the lead. Brendan's car flipped over on its side and landed on top of the GT Porsche before they both came to rest in the gravel trap. Thankfully, they were both unharmed. There was a chance for Toyota to get back in the race, but Kazuki Nakajima picked up a puncture. The flailing tyre had destroyed the rear of the car. Then just as Romain Dumas was starting to close the gap at the front, he got tagged in traffic, ruining his attack. At the flag, it was the number 7 Audi that came through to take the win. Or so they thought.
Final timeout, nice gently over the cut, and takes the checkered flag. It's a great
P1. Well done, everyone, from Audi Sport, and thank you to both car crews for the work during the pit stop.
Thanks for the fantastic work, unbelievable. Really, really nice.
As the team celebrated, the scrutineers were looking at the car, and they weren't happy. Part of the new car didn't comply with the rules, it was too low, and so they were excluded after the race. That handed the win and the points to the number 2 Porsche. In LMP2, it was the RGR squad who claimed the first victory of the year. Davide Rigon and Sam Bird had put in a great drive to claim the win in GTE Pro. And it was another AF Corsa Ferrari that won the GTE AM, getting their seasons off to a great start.
Spa-Francorchamps means the most beautiful racetrack in the world, with a huge amount of history. This made this place mythical and such a legendary place, let's say.
After the chills of Silverstone, there were already a few scores to be settled. There was a huge crowd ready to party and enjoy all the action in the sunshine of the Ardennes.
Signal has been given, we have started the 6 hours of Spa. Signal has been given, we have started the 6 hours of Spa.
And they didn't have to wait long. It was Porsche who'd locked out the front row in qualifying. The Toyotas and Audis were right with them. However, it was our points leaders that were the first to hit trouble.
We just have to manage this to the end, unfortunately, mate. Do what we can, get the points.
It was going to be a long day for the number 2 Porsche squad with a faulty hybrid. An epic duel developed for second place. First, Sebastian Buemi dived down the inside of the Audi of Luca De Grassi. However, De Grassi wasn't done and retook the place, passing the Toyota with two wheels on the grass at almost 300 kilometres an hour. But it still wasn't over as Buemi swept around the outside at the bus stop to get back ahead. After some quick thinking at Toyota and double stinting their tyres, Sebastian Buemi had jumped into the lead. Under pressure from Timo Bernhard in the Porsche, the Swiss driver then outbraked himself into the bus stop and the Porsche was able to pounce into Lesource hairpin. However, Buemi hadn't given up and fought back down the hill to get back ahead. By the fearsome Eau Rouge, the Toyota just had the edge. With just over an hour and a half gone, Nicky Team in the Aston Martin had a huge crash when he was hit by Simon Dolan in the G-Drive prototype that was trying to lap him. There was a sigh of relief in the Aston Martin garage as Nicky walked away. No one could match the pace of the Toyota, then disaster struck. Without warning, the engine blew. They were back in the garage and out of the race. Audi couldn't believe their luck as the number 8 car that was having its own problems was handed the lead. With just over an hour left, the safety car was rushed out after Stefan Mucha had a terrifying accident at the top of Radeon. His Ford GT hit the wall at high speed. The paddock took a deep breath waiting for news. Thankfully, the car did its job and he was okay. At the front of GTE Pro, the AF Corsa Ferrari of Jimmy Bruni and James Calado were dominating. But then Davide Rigon seemed to overtake with ease, and with under 10 minutes to go, they were in trouble and heading for the pits and retirement. The pain was clear to see in the driver's body language. Then, with just 5 minutes to go, the lead in LMP2 changed as Nico Lapierre somehow managed to dive around the outside of Pipo Durrani in an amazing move. After a tough 6 hours, it was Audi who headed to victory, making up for the mistakes at Silverstone.
What a strange race. I mean, we certainly didn't have the pace to win it, but we had the luck on our side and others had misfortune, and that's the way it goes. Just delighted for the team. We've had some hard races, and to finally get that win, I'd like to think it really kickstarts our season.
In LMP2, it was a very happy Signatec Alpine squad who took the win. In GTE Pro, Sam Bird and Davide Rigon knew that they had lucked into the victory. And in GTM, it was the number 98 Aston that cruised home for the win. Next up, the big one, the 24 Hours of Le Mans, where for 1 week a year, this French city becomes the centre of the motorsport
amazing
world.
Here. Surprise, unexpected. Yes, I've seen it before, but that's a really big. That's a really big.
This is the race the teams want to win more than any other. On hand were more stars than you'd find in a Hollywood blockbuster movie. And the man tasked with the job of starting the race, Brad Pitt. With almost perfect timing, the clouds burst and the rain came down. And for the first time in history, the race started behind the safety car.
Safety car's in. Green lights all around the track. No overtaking before they cross the line.
So after almost an hour, battle finally commenced. Mike Conway in the number 6 Toyota was loving the drying conditions and soon charged past the Porsches and into the lead. With conditions rapidly improving, it wasn't long before the teams pitted and switched to slick tyres. But when Audi pitted André Lotterer, it wasn't just for tyres. They had a broken turbocharger that needed fixing urgently. This wasn't the start they wanted to the big race. The GTE Pro battle had produced as many headlines before the race as anyone else. Ford returning 50 years after their legendary fight with Ferrari. With the AF Corsa Ferrari struggling early on, It was going to be down to the American Rissi Competizione team to try and defend Ferrari's honour. However, the new Ford GT was looking very strong. With just over 8 hours gone, Brendan Hartley was forced into the garage with a faulty water pump that was making his Porsche overheat. It looked like Le Mans was slipping away from the number one crew. This toughest of all races was beginning to take its toll. As morning came, the Toyotas were in second and third positions, but swapped places so that car 5 could take up the charge.
What's the team order? Yanni 56 seconds ahead. Yanni 56 seconds ahead.
Anthony Davidson steadily closed in on the leader. And then the Toyota outpaced the Porsche down the straight, taking the advantage. Just as Toyota started to think this could finally be their year, everything started to unravel.
I'm not accelerating, I have no power.
With just over a lap to go, would the Toyota be able to hang on?
Yeah, okay, keep pushing. Car 5 has lost power.
Just as Kaz Nakajima crossed the line to start the final lap, the Toyota ground to a halt. Neil Jani in the Porsche came flying through to take the lead.
Something car power cycle. The ignition off, main off. Main on and ignition on back again.
Can you answer, please?
Alpha 111, restart the engine. Alpha 111, press HV to restart the engine.
Porsche had stolen the victory as well as the double points in one of the most dramatic finishes in the race's long history. Porsche couldn't believe their luck.
For the 84th edition of the 24 Hours of Le Mans, we are giving it.
Oh my God! You're the greatest! You're the greatest!
First of all, I'm very sorry for them after such a race. But you can imagine how we can be happy also. I mean, for me or for Mark, it was a dream to win with Porsche. I said before the start, that was my dream forever. I guess he's the same, Massimo Berna also. And it happened with a lot of luck, but that's a part of the game. And it's our day, we can say like that.
The Toyota team were distraught. Nobody could believe what had just happened. In LMP2, it was a home win for the French Signatec Alpine team. In GTE Pro, Ford had come here with a mission. 50 years after their first win, they'd done it again. They'd taken the victory. And in GTE Am, it was the all-American crew of Scuderia Corsa Ferrari who took the win. But Le Mans 2016 belonged to Porsche.
Nürburgring is the most famous track in Germany. I mean, it's by far the oldest, with a lot of histories, good races here. It's legacy, it's speed, and it's a heart of German racing.
As the WEC circus rolled into Germany, there was another huge crowd. With several German teams and drivers competing, the fans were all expecting a great race. they wouldn't be disappointed. In qualifying, it was Audi who locked out the front row and took the advantage. However, a hard-charging Timo Bernhard forced his Porsche into second place at the first corner, splitting his rivals. The GTE Pro leaders had been inseparable throughout the first stint. Richie Stanaway for Aston Martin and Harry Tinknell for Ford even pitted together. As the pit crews battled each other, there was a fuel spill at Ford. Suddenly, the car was engulfed in flames. The team fought the fire, and Andy Priaulx, having just strapped himself in, had to quickly bail out and get to safety. In the first half of the race, the GTE AM class was very close. The lead changed several times, but Matthias Lauda eventually found a way through in the Aston Martin and pulled clear of the pack. At the head of the race, it had turned into a massive game of chess as Audi and Porsche matched each other move for move. There was no let-up in the pain for Toyota. Damage in traffic and a general lack of pace left them wondering what they needed to do to get a break this season. Back in GTE Pro, Nicky Team was feeling the pressure from the Ferrari. Somehow, Jimmy Bruni managed to cut across the front of the Aston Martin and take the lead. The race was about to be turned on its head. Mark Leeb was leading and comfortably in control when he accidentally collided with the GTE Porsche of Khaled El Kabezi as he tried to lap him. Leeb tried to dive through on the inside, but the gap closed. His car was damaged and forced him to pit. He also picked up a drive-through penalty that cost him the lead. It was an expensive mistake for the drivers' championship leaders, and Mark Leeb knew it. The main beneficiary of all this drama was their teammates in the number one Porsche, who were heading for victory.
Boys, well done. Absolutely blinding. You boys have fought this in the team on track. Well done, guys. Well done, everyone.
Yeah, we had a tough first part of the season, and we really wanted a victory on home ground for Porsche. And I mean, Porsche victory was important, but yeah, we really wanted that so bad. And very happy, very proud of that crew to come back after the first part of the season. So really, really good.
This was the track where they took their first victory last year en route to the 2015 World Championship. So could history repeat itself? In LMP2, the Signatec Alpine squad extended their lead in the points. In GTE AM, it was Aston Martin on the top step of the podium. And in GTE Pro, the victory went to a very happy AF Corsa Ferrari team.
Le Mans is very important in Mexico. We had Pedro Rodriguez win Le Mans about 40, 45 years ago. So there's a heritage, and I think people are excited and waiting to see the modern Le Mans cars in person.
Mexico City was a step into the unknown for the FIA World Endurance Championship. This was a brand new event and felt like a party as everyone was enjoying the relaxed Latin atmosphere while the drivers were getting a hero's reception.
Yeah, I don't know where the next stop is, but I'm going where you're going. There'll be even more people in the next few hours because the race is still a little bit away. So, yeah, listen to the noise already. They're getting pretty ballistic. So, yeah, it's really good to be here. They've made a big effort, and it's going to be a really awesome race.
In In the race, again, it looked like Audi and Porsche were going to be evenly matched. Lucas de Grassi made a break out front. However, his Audi teammate Andrea Lotterer wasn't happy and was losing time. The team decided to pit early for new tyres, forcing them to rethink their strategy. Things were still not going well at Toyota. Mike Conway found himself in trouble after pushing the ESM car into the wall, and it earned him a drive-through penalty. Meanwhile, the other Toyota had bigger problems as Kaz Nakajima was forced to retire the 5 car with an electrical fault. In LMP2, the lead battle got a bit too close. A light touch from Roman Rusinov sent Ricardo Gonzalez into a spin, the Mexican driver finding himself facing the wrong way on the track. It was then nature's turn to try and upset everyone's plans. With light rain moving across the track, the leaders had closed up and Brendan Hartley saw a chance to dive past the number 8 Audi and get to the front of the pack. Loic Duval was then almost immediately under attack from the number 2 Porsche. The Audi was struggling on the greasy track. Porsche were happy with how the race was working out. Audi not so much. Audi's day was about to get a lot worse. Oliver Jarvis had just got into the number 8 Audi when a bearing broke at the left front of the car, sending it into a frightening spin and off the track. Jarvis managed to get the car back to the garage for repairs, but a chance of a win in Mexico had gone. In GT Pro, it was Aston Martin that were dominating the class. However, Nicky Team lost the back of the car in the damp conditions, sliding off into the barriers, damaging the wing and diffuser. It was a battle of the 911s for the lead in GTE Am. David Enemar Hansen running long into the corner and handing the advantage to the KCMG Porsche. With just over half an hour to go, the leader in LMP2 went off. René Rast sent into a spin after a brake disc failure. To the delight of the Mexican fans, that meant that local heroes RGR went to the head of their class. The race had one final surprise for Timo Bernhard at the front. The wet track caught him out and sent the car towards the wall. His eyes must have been on Stokes as he just managed to stop the Porsche in time. Thankfully for Timo, he had enough of an advantage over the Audi to bring home the win for Porsche to make it back-to-back wins for the number one car.
Winners in Mexico, baby! Winners in Mexico! Awesome! Good job, boys. Cool down, that mate. Yeah, baby! Yeah, baby!
In LMP2, it was a fairy tale home victory for Mexico's Ricardo Gonzalez and his RGR team.
Very happy, very tense moments at the end with the rain, 2 second gap to second place. I didn't want to watch the TV anymore.
In GTE Pro, Aston Martin were back on form with their first win for over a year. And after a tough race, it was a first win in GTE Am for Abu Dhabi Proton Racing.
You name it, the track has it. Uphill, downhill, off camber, camber, high speed, low speed, sweepers, hard braking zones, long straightaways. It's got it all. And it's a challenge to drive and a challenge for the teams to set the car up.
So the series had headed over the border and into the USA to a very hot Austin in Texas. A race that would run from day into night for the Lone Star Le Mans around the circuit of the Americas. It was a steamy 37 degrees Celsius at the start, but that seemed to suit the Audis at the front. As they charged uphill into the first corner, Loic Duval ran a little wide, allowing Mark Webber in the Porsche to briefly squeeze alongside in the battle for second place, the teams anxiously watching on. The Toyotas were looking much more competitive here in Texas, with Seb Buemi taking on Romain Dumas' Porsche and beating him to grab fourth place. And when Anthony Davidson got in the Toyota, he was battling hard with Brendan Hartley's Porsche and gave him a real run for his money. In the end, Hartley retook third position and Davidson had to admit defeat. But the Englishman really made the New Zealander work for it. Most drivers opted not to double stint to help them in the hot conditions. However, there was a tight battle at the front of LMP2, with both Ricardo Gonzalez and Matt Rau doing double duty, and they were battling wheel to wheel. There was also the added complication of the dazzling low sun shining right in their eyes as the night drew in. Everything looked to be going Audi's way until suddenly the leading car of Loic de Waal lost all power and stopped on the track. He quickly did a reset of the car and it fired back into life. The team were left wondering why the car had cut out. The second Audi, who'd been right behind them, were promoted to the lead. However, a long pit stop cost them time, allowing Porsche to close in on the pit stop cycle. There seemed to be an air of frustration creeping into how the Audi team was working. Suddenly, a collision between the 66 Ford GT and the Manor P2 car caused a full course yellow. This was a massive gift to Porsche, who could now pit as the field was held at 80 kilometres an hour and it handed them the lead. As the clock counted down to the end of the 6 hours, it was going to be a hat-trick of wins for the number one Porsche as Timo Bernard brought the car home.
That's three in a row.
Audi knew they'd missed a great opportunity in Ostend, but there was no lack of respect for their Porsche rivals as Dr. Wolfgang Ulrich congratulated Fritz Enzinger on a well-earned victory. In LMP2, it was another win for Signatec Alpine as they closed in on the title. In GT Pro, it was the Dane train Aston Martin number 95 who took a victory. And in GTE Am, Paul Dallolana, Pedro Lamy and Matthias Lauda were dominant, winning the class.
This track means for me, first it's home and comfort, then third one, Mount Fuji.
It was in Japan that we all found out that we'd be losing one of the great stars of the WEC, Mark Webber, who announced his retirement from the sport at the end of the season.
Had a great career. I've really enjoyed the people I've worked with. It's been a privilege, been an honour to have been associated with so many great people and brands, and still am. You know, it's hard to do this job, half pregnant. You know, especially with your teammates and with testing and all the things that have gone behind the scenes. It's not fair for me to keep peeling away my energy levels in that sense. So, made the difficult but also very straightforward call in, like, you know, I have to do it like that because it's the only way I operate. You have to do it properly or not at all. And yeah, it's gone very well, and time goes quick, you know, really, really quick. And you know, my parents are not getting any younger, the people that obviously I love being with, and you know, all of our personal lives move along, so you've got to take all that into account, and looking forward to the break. Qualifying had been the closest in WEC history, but it was the Audi of Lucas Degrassi who was starting at the front. That set up a very close battle into the first corner, and despite a little bit of contact, everybody made it round. Ben Trelawney was losing power and had to pit with a failing hybrid system.
That would force the number 7 Audi into retirement. Meanwhile, Kamui Kobayashi was inspired on home soil and charging, taking second place from Mark Webber. In GT Pro, it was the Fords of Harry Tinknell and Oli Pla that were looking strong and leading the pack, whereas their rivals in the Ferraris were getting just a little bit too close for comfort. The LMP2 class was also close. Gustavo Menezes in the Signatec Alpine was trying to pass the manicar of Richard Bradley. Bradley was having nothing of it, forcing the American out wide and over the kerbs. He got away with it, but it was a wake-up call to the championship leaders, who really didn't need to be taking those type of chances. There was no let-up in the chase at the front, with Audi, Toyota and Porsche leapfrogging each other for the lead through the pit stop cycle. In fact, with just over 3.5 hours gone, they were getting closer. Timo Bernard was pushing hard in the number one Porsche and reeling in the Toyota of Stefan Sarrazin. He pulled alongside on the main straight and took second place going into the first corner. In the number six Toyota, Stefan Sarrazin had other ideas. And using the GT traffic expertly, he dived back ahead of the Porsche. Bernard wasn't going to give up though, and next time around he attacked again. It was a drag race down the long front straight. This time the Porsche managed to squeeze just a little bit more energy out of the batteries and kept the position. Unlike their teammates, the championship leaders in Porsche number 2 were having a tough weekend and struggling for pace. For whatever reason, they just couldn't keep up with the lead group. After a pit stop and a driver change, the pendulum for the battle for second swung back towards Toyota. This time, Kamui Kobayashi retook the position from Brendan Hartley. The Toyota driver was desperate to close back in on the leading Audi.
Okay, look, how are you doing? Can you stay in for another stint?
I'm okay, but it depends if I'm quick or not.
Look, you are by far our fastest driver.
You are playing with my ego now.
I'm not playing with you. It's 5 seconds to the Toyota and 8 seconds to the Porsche.
As the race entered the sixth and final hour, at last the team showed their hands. Audi pitted and switched to a brand new set of Michelin tyres, hoping the extra grip would give them the pace to take the win. The Toyota garage was looking very excited as they made their last roll of the dice.
And boxes left, press speed confirm, boxes left for fuel only.
Toyota were gambling on double stinting their Michelin tyres, spending less time at the pit stop and jumping into the lead of the race. In LMP2, the RGR team were about to try the same tactic and only go for fuel. The Dunlop tyre engineer had the thumbs up, the tyres were good for another stint, and it worked as they got the jump on the black and orange G-Drive car, their nearest rivals. Much to the delight of those in the pit garage. Both classes were heading for a nail-biting finale. Will Stevens wasn't giving up and went for the lead. Bruno Senna edged him towards the pit wall. Stevens got through, but the officials weren't happy.
Team manager, car 26, tell your driver to give the position back to car 43.
So Will had to drop back and try his luck again. The RGR car on older tyres didn't have the grip. So as Stevens came by, this time on the other side of Senna, there was no fight back from the 43. The last lap approach, there was a look of concern on the faces at Toyota. Not going for tyres was a gamble. Was it the right one? The Audi was closing fast. On the last lap, the Toyota was struggling through traffic and Loic Duval in the Audi had them in sight. But but nothing was going to prevent Toyota taking a stunning home victory at Fuji to the delight of their fans. The Audi only 1.4 seconds behind what was the closest ever finish in WEC history.
Yeah, awesome drive, Kevin. Awesome drive. Well done. Well done.
Amazing. Great. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
And it was really great to be here. And of course, I think winning race, it's hard, but I think we did our best, and thank you very much.
Too quick.
Of course, in the Le Mans, it's for us, it's really hard, but at least we want to win that our home race. And we are really confident to after qualify to win today.
It had been an outstanding LMP2 race, and G-Drive came out on top. The Fords were untouchable in GTE Pro all weekend and finished first and second. And in the AM class, it was the 98 Aston Martin making it back-to-back victories.
The layout of this track is quite interesting because if you take an aerial view, if you look at the circuit from the top, it's actually a Shanghai, a Chinese character that means Shanghai.
Toyota were now a real threat to Porsche, and as the series arrived in China, the championship battle was looking very interesting. Another close qualifying. Brendan Hartley in the number one Porsche had grabbed pole, but by the first corner, Sebastian Buemi in the Toyota shot around the outside to take the lead in the number five. As they got onto the long back straight, Hartley was ready to attack and managed to retake the lead just in time before the safety car was scrambled. The safety car was on the track because the 45 manner of Matthias Besch had spun at the first corner and hit the Aston Martin of Richie Stanaway. The race was over for both drivers before they'd even got to the second corner. Also heading for the pits was the GTE Pro Class leading Ferrari of Davide Rigon. Luckily for him, it was only a puncture from catching some debris from the crash, and they could carry on. When the race resumed, the pace was breathless. In LMP2, Alex Brundle flew past Nico Lapierre in the blue Signatec Alpine, the G-Drive car taking the lead in the class. The Signatec team knew they just had to play safe, and the title could be theirs here in Shanghai. Everything was running smoothly at the front for Brendan Hartley in his Porsche, but there was a scare for him and his crew when they needed to change the nose of the car after it had been damaged by rubber debris. It cost them time, but not the lead. Jimmy Bruni and Marco Sorensen went wheel to wheel in the battle for third in GTE Pro. It was also an important fight as Ferrari and Aston Martin were still very close at the Manufacturers' Championship. Bruni in the Ferrari somehow held on around the outside and took the position. Great driving by both men. At the head of the race, it looked like Toyota's strategy was keeping them with the Porsches. Then Mike Conway picked up a puncture. That forced the team to rethink their plans, but there was still a chance that they could come back into the fight. Toyota quickly took the decision to swap the order of the cars out on track, allowing the six car ahead and up into third place. The number six could now push on and try to catch their title rivals in second position. The Porsche's tyres were fading fast, and Kamui Kobayashi saw the opportunity to pounce and take the spot. This was all helping to close the gap in the Drivers' Championship. With the LMP2 title on the line, Nico Lapierre didn't want to push it. His rivals were just ahead in third position, but all he had to do was sit it out and wait in fourth. However, that plan very nearly went wrong on the very last lap when the GTE AM battle ahead of them came together. The Signatec Alpine was lucky to come out unscathed. At the flag, it was four wins out of the last five races for the number one Porsche.
That's the chicken flag. That's the chicken flag. Come on, mate. Nice one. Good job.
G-Drive took a dominant win in LMP2, but the title was heading to the French Signatec Alpine team.
World champions, baby! Steph, Nico, they did an incredible job. We were fighting for the podium till the very end, but the most important job was done. We're officially world champions, and there's no better feeling in the world.
In GT Pro, a mighty performance by Harry Tinknell and Andy Priel took the 67 Ford to victory. GTE AM went to the 98 Aston Martin crew. At Porsche, though, it was job done. The win was enough to secure the LMP1 manufacturer's title for the second year running.
It's important for me to work with people, and it's important for me to feel that all these people like to work together and that they really put a lot of effort, each one from his part, to make the thing happen to its best. I think this is something that I enjoy the most. For me, it is very important that the personalities are ready to be a part of a big family and know that together they can be stronger than the individual people. This was for me always important to make it happen, and I was very happy to feel through the years that it's the right people that are around me.
The final race in Bahrain was full of emotion. After 18 incredible years in endurance racing, it was farewell to Audi Sport. The team were determined to go out on a high. It was also Mark Webber's last race, and F1 star and fellow Aussie Daniel Ricciardo was on hand to witness it. It was fitting that for the final race of the year, it was Audi on pole. Loic Duval led the field away into the tight right-handed first corner. Behind, it seemed the whole LMP2 field was spread out across the track, but somehow everyone got through. With the driver's title on the line, Neil Jarny in the number two Porsche was pushing hard and soon went up to second place. But the championship leaders were about to have an early scare.
I have a puncture, fucking GT8 on the rear.
The puncture had occurred whilst lapping the KCMG Porsche, and there'd been a slight contact. Neil Jarny and the team were worried. The rear wheel had locked up, and if the damage proved more severe, the driver's title could be slipping away. In the GTE AM class, things weren't going to plan for Aston Martin. They had to win if they wanted any chance at the title, but a spin by Paul Dallolana was just the beginning of their problems. The very next lap, the Aston engine let go. Despite Paul's best effort, he couldn't make it back to the garage and had to pull over, which meant that the AF Corsa Ferrari crew knew they were champions. Incredibly, it was also going wrong for Aston Martin in GTE Pro. Just as they were on course for the Manufacturers' Championship, the wheel literally came off their charge. Johnny Adam dragged the car back to the pits on three wheels as the team sprang into action to get the car fixed and back into the race. the GT Drivers' Championship was still up for grabs for the 95 Aston Martin, with Nicky Thiem and Marco Sorensen in control of their own destiny and leading the class.
OK, box now, driver change.
Down at Porsche, Mark Webber was getting ready to take over the number one car for the last time and was in with a shot of a final podium before he hung up his helmet for good. Next door, despite that early scare, the Porsche number two crew was still on course to take the driver's title. For Audi though, it was an emotional last lap as the team headed to their 108th and final victory before they bowed out of endurance racing.
Okay, dude. Anyway, you won the race. Fantastic job. Lucas, Loic, Holly, Fasti and crew, you're the best of the business. Thanks, Audi, for an amazing year.
The WEC driver's crown was heading to Porsche for a second consecutive year.
Thanks to the team. I mean, it's an honor to drive a Porsche around on a racetrack, and to win Le Mans and the World Championship is something really special and will always be there.
An impressive finish to the year by G-Drive came too late to challenge for the LMP2 Championship, which had already gone to Signatec. Aston Martin secured the GTE Teams and Drivers' Championships.
He deserves it so much. He did a stunning job this year, and again, I'm just super proud of everything.
Here he is.
The GTE manufacturers and AM drivers titles went the way of Ferrari after a tough season.
The team was perfect in every situation, especially through the race. We always had a good strategy. No mistake, and at the end the result is there, so it's perfect.
So farewell to Audi, and the teams made a guard of honour as they lined the pit lane to say goodbye and salute their achievements within the sport and join them in celebrating one last time as they headed for the podium. Incredible season, and although Audi won't be back, for everyone else the competition goes on and will start all over again in April 2017 at Silverstone.
Coming up after the break, we head to Sydney Motorsport Park as our continued coverage of the Swan Insurance Australasian Superbike Championship final round continues.